Welcome to this episode of the Brush and Soap and Blade Podcast, where we look forward to shaving every day. Welcome to episode 92 of the podcast. My name is Rick DeWeese. I'll be your host this week. This week, we're talking about a shave of the day and what... And then after that, we'll talk about a job that you love? Really? Come on. Another shave of the day. Another shave of the day, along with a few tips. And then finally, a rant about rants. Yeah, it's time to do that. Another thing that's terribly interesting about this week's podcast is the shaves of the day that I did. In fact, all of the shaving that I did this week was, in fact, with a 1914 Eveready, otherwise known as the Little Lather Catcher. Okay, it's got like a damascene type round handle on it, and it's got it's brass, and it's got a top that instead of having a like a lever for your thumb on the back of it, you lift it up, and so it's a little bit different configuration. And I used that thing all week. When I first started the week, just to give you an idea how Thursday was going, okay? When I started out, I called it a gem, and then I continued to think that it was a gem, and then it was like, I spilled coffee on myself Thursday morning. I mean, it was just an absolute miserable morning, and then, well, it got worse. Anyhow, the razor that I was using all week, and the one that that I have enjoyed all week has been, in fact, my 1914 Eveready, single-edged brass razor. Anyhow, that's kind of the show today. It was a little exciting this week in the old mobile studio, and as the sound effects have alluded to, well, there's something exciting that happens on the podcast that I dare say, well, you probably don't hear all the time. It's not very often that you actually get to record one of these, but I did. Anyhow, let's get on with this show. So we're driving down the road on a kind of a damp morning. Been raining all night, and I mean all night. Just goodness. We had thunder and lightning for, I don't know, like 3 or 4 hours last night. I've never heard it that much. You know, it was incredible. The whole time I was editing the podcast, it was thunder and lightning and carrying on, and luckily I was on a laptop, you know, so I was just on battery, so it's not like I have to worry about any of my equipment or anything, and all my equipment's on a big UPS system anyhow, but, it was amazing. It really was, you know, and some of it was close, some of it was far. It'd get close, then it'd go far, then it'd come get close again. It was really wild. It was like, you know, the whole front was just running past my back door. It was, kind of incredible. Anyhow, so it has been raining all night long. And so this morning I decided to, go old school. And at the same time that I'm, you know, in my head going old school, I also decided to... you know, pick out some favorites that from the past. And so what I ended up doing was soaking the 830 bore brush, the Samog 830, which was the first Samog that I had, because I had the 830 before I had the 1305. And in fact, it was one of my first, well, decent brushes. And at least what I would term decent, you know, more than $10. You know, I had a Vanderhagen brush. Okay, it was okay. It softened up a little bit. I never would call it, you know, like a real, real good brush. It was an adequate brush. It was okay. My Smog is much nicer, either one of them. Anyhow, there's a little bit of a memory there with the older Smog brush that I have. So the soap that I grabbed this morning, you know, because I was marching down memory lane a little bit was some Mystic Water Shaving Soap, particularly Jeff's Lavender, that scent. Good stuff. Now, I remember way back when that there used to be a lot of commotion, I don't know if there still is, about Mystic Water being hard to lather and difficult and everything else. And I must admit, I've never had an issue. And I attribute that to my soft water. I've never had an issue with lathering up Mystic Water. Some people do. I've seen the posts. I've heard from them. It's just, you know, some people I know do have issues with lathering it. I never have. So I'm really, you know, when people ask me, what do you do about this? What do you do about that? I have a difficult time sometimes relating just because I don't have the same issues. So anyhow, the Jeff's Lavender is an absolutely fabulous scent. Really, really enjoyed that. And, it's nice face feel and everything else. I mean, the Mystic Water soaps are just, I really like them. You know, people talk nowadays about the Katie's bubbles and all this other stuff, but for me, the Mystic Waters are, they're a really good soap. So anyhow, that's just, so I picked up my tub of Mystic Waters Jeff Lavender and proceeded to lather up in ye olde salsa bowl. And just because that's been around forever. And so the single-edged razor that I have is, just an old, run-of-the-mill brass single-edged razor that, the top cap flips back and you slide the blade in and it's all good and got a very, very nice shave with it. But thanks, lady. I just got in a wreck. Well, isn't that nice? That's what happens when people don't pay attention to what the hell's going on. Oh, well, be right back. Okay, well, I am back again. You heard it here almost live, at least recorded anyhow. Jeez, and spilled my coffee again. So, let's see, this is twice now today that my coffee has spilled all over me. It's beginning to be a habit. I don't necessarily like it. Okay, so, lady coming home from work, and there's somebody that stopped in front of me for a turn. No big deal. I put on the brakes. The lady coming behind me, I don't know if she wasn't paying attention or whatever. She was going probably a little bit fast, maybe a little bit close. She ended up trying to put on the brakes and bumped into the back of my truck. Now, one thing that you must know about the mobile studio is the mobile studio has a pretty significant trailer hitch on the back of the vehicle. And I'm thinking to myself, holy crap, that's going to tear up. That would have gone right through the radiator and just, that would have done a number on a vehicle. Okay, so we pull over and the first thing I ask when I get out of the car is, are you okay? And she admitted that, yes, she was. It's like, okay. So we take a look at my truck because I happen to be around that backside first and no significant damage whatsoever. Doesn't really seem to, it didn't really care. Like, yeah, okay, no big deal. It's probably no worse than what I do trying to back up, to hitch up a trailer or something. You know, it's, the truck probably didn't even sneeze. It's just, yeah, okay, whatever. So then I got to thinking, oh God, I hate to see the damage on this woman's car. And it looks like it was a little Honda Pilot, and it looked like the car was raised up just enough in the wheelbase so that the trailer hitch went under the front bumper and the bumpers actually contacted each other. And so the good news is no damage to her car to speak of, really. I mean, no damage at all. It's just, it looked maybe like her license plate holder was, kind of pushed back just a bit hard into the plastic bumper. There might have been one piece of foam molding that was exposed if something, got stretched or pushed just a little bit different. But to look at the vehicle, it's like, no big deal. So I told her, I said, okay, I'm okay with it. It's like, are you okay with it? She said, oh, thank you, God. I'm thinking, the whole time she's thinking, oh, my God, my insurance. So anyhow, I looked at her and I said, well, I'm okay with it. You okay with it? And she said, oh, thank you. She gave me a hug and, we went on our merry way. And quite honestly, that's the way things like that should go. I also took a look at her tires. I was going to tell her that, if her tires were worn out, she might want to replace them or move if she had good tires, because it was a front-wheel drive car, so... If she had better tires on the back, she might want to get them rotated, get good tires on the front so that she's got better braking. But her tires were in good shape, so that wasn't an issue. But, just a gentle reminder that, hey, it's wet out here, and, give yourself a little bit more stopping distance and have a good day. And so, all in all, good stuff. So, no big deal. Luckily nobody was hurt. That's the big thing. You hate to think of, somebody getting injured in a car accident. That's not good at all. And, you do your best you can with what you have, and, hopefully spread the joy and optimism to, everyone you meet. And, maybe if, everybody did that, this place would be, well, just a little bit better world. And, kind of the way it goes. So all in all, not a big deal, but it's curious that I was able to, I'll have to play around with the editing on this, see if I can make it sound like it's a whole lot worse than it is. Oh, how often do you get a chance to hear a car wreck in progress? Oh, goodness, good stuff. So the other day, I had a conversation with a young lady. She's about 23 years old, and she said something that, well, at the time, I spoke to her, well, at length about the subject, and at the time, I sincerely was trying to help her. Reflecting, though, it really just kind of set my teeth on edge. And the reason is it's not the first time I've heard this. So, I was talking to this young lady, and she had moved down with her family from another location. And I asked her what she was going to do. I didn't know if she was in school or, going to, working at a job or whatever. She said, well, I'm probably going to be going to school. I said, okay, got to talking and asked her if she'd been going to school previously, and she said yes, she was. And so I asked, at 23 years old, I thought it was a reasonable question to ask, well, what's your major? And she proceeded to tell me that her major was X. Okay, fair enough. What happened? Well, I found out I didn't like it. Okay. How'd you find out you didn't like it? Well, it required talking to people, and I found out that I didn't like talking to people. And that's what kind of set me off, because I asked her, I said, well, wait a minute. You knew that about yourself beforehand, didn't you? And she kind of looked at me, and I said, so why did you pick that as a field of study? She said, well, I was trying to find something that I love. And that's when I got to admit, something inside my brain, just a gear snapped in two or something. I'm not quite sure what it was, but I heard clanking as the piece was falling down in the bilges of my mind there, because, well, I just, something had just set me off. Because she said, I'm trying to find something that I love. And I went, why? And she said, well, Everybody's always told me, here, let me say that again. Everybody's always told me that when it comes to a job, you need to find a job that you love. And I said, okay, time out. How about a job that you're capable at? Because just because you love a job doesn't mean you're good at it, okay? And quite honestly, an employer is not going to pay you for your love and passion of a job. They're going to pay you for, well, your capability at being able to perform a job. And like I said, this is not the first time that I had heard that statement, said with some conviction that, you know, we're out here and we need to find the job that we love. Because if we can find the job that we love, then you know, it's really not like work. At which point I said, well, you know, they call it work for a reason. If they called it something else and if you had fun every day, they'd call it Disneyland and you'd have to pay to get in. And so we talked for a little bit. And what I ended up going down the route of is I said, okay, first off, in order for you to do something that you are good at, you need to know what you're good at. And more than likely, you already do. You already know what you're good at and what you're capable at. You could probably go home right now. In fact, I even suggested it to the young lady that you could probably go home right now and write down on a piece of paper some things that you are good at. Now, once you get that, then you can sit down and say, all right, with these competencies, or in fact, with these gifts from our maker, because, you know, I'm a firm believer that everybody's good at something, and that doesn't come just out of the clear blue, in my opinion. So with these gifts, you were given these gifts for a reason. And the reason was to use them. And in using them, if you, again, play to your strengths, as you use these gifts, you can be successful. Why? Not necessarily because you love it, but because you're good at it. You're competent at this skill. You can do these things. There are some people, for example, that can sit there and look at a computer screen full of numbers all day long and understand and find issues and find problems, and they are so detail-oriented that they can tell you, for example, that this box being green means that this box needs to be checked off and this box isn't checked off, so there's a problem and we need to fix that. There's other people that look at that same screen and their eyes go bleary and they can't see the forest for the trees no matter how hard they try. Yet those same people that have difficulty with a computer screen can go around and talk to people about all kinds of subjects and not have a bit of problem conversing at all and getting into intimate details. There's others that really don't want to talk to people at all. They just feel uncomfortable doing so. Okay, each one of those is a gift. But if you're in a job that requires talking to people and you don't like talking to people, you are not playing to your strengths. You are playing, in fact, to your weaknesses. And playing to your weaknesses is a surefire way to, well, fail. And typically fail miserably, at least in your opinion, because you will be not only not real good at your job, but you'll be miserable doing it. That's a pretty good definition of fail. So the idea, first off, is find out what you're good at. Sit down and take inventory of yourself. What is it that you're good at doing? Are you good at reading? Are you good at writing? Are you good at math? Are you good with computers? Are you good with figuring things out? And be honest with yourself. Just because somebody at some point said, ooh, you're good with computers, does not really mean you're good with computers. It might, but on the other hand, it, well, might not. They just might have been a whole lot less familiar with computers. So once you get to that stage where you have an idea what it is that you are good at, then start looking for fields of endeavor that work to those strengths. Start trying to figure out what you can do with the gifts that God gave you. Because again, like I've always said, it would be a real shame if at the end of your life, you stood up in front of the good Lord and he said, what did you do with the gifts that I gave you? And you look at him and say, what gifts? You know, it'd really be sad if he looked at you and said, well, I gave you an extremely detail-oriented mind that also happens to love mathematics. What did you ever do with that? And you look at the person, oh, nothing. I became a janitor. You know? That would be hard to admit at the end of your life. That you had a gift and you never used it. What a shame. Especially when somebody that's detail-oriented, that is good at mathematics, can probably earn a little bit better living than a janitor. I may be wrong, but could be. But the thing is that you can, you should, I would think, know this about yourself ahead of time. Now, the really scary part, and the thing that really frustrated me more than anything else with this conversation with this young lady, was that I came away with the impression, the distinct impression, that she had never heard this stuff before, with the exception of her parents. The problem is that, well, it was her parents, and as all of us know, there becomes a certain age when it really doesn't matter what the parents say, it's just, well, unworthy of consideration. I get that. So, you know, I think of the fact, okay, we've known this forever, okay? I mean, this is not rocket science. This is not a new concept. But as I was talking to her, it became obvious that she had really never heard this before, and it dawned on me that we do not, in any way, shape, or form, teach our children to understand what they are good at and take inventory of what they are good at. You know, so a very simple question for a young person. What classes do you enjoy and do you get good grades at without really trying? You know, do you have a mind that allows you to memorize history and historical details to the point where you can just regurgitate that easily on a test because it just kind of latches in there? There are some people that cannot do that. There are others that can. So think about the classes that, you know, you do pretty good in, but you don't really have to study. You may have a gift there. But the thing that was disturbing is, again, like I said, we have, as a society, told these children for ages that the only way to get a good job is to go to college. And apparently, at some point, and I have missed this discussion, but I've seen the effects of it. At some point, somebody has told our kids that they shouldn't get a job, you know, that they don't like, but they should get a job that they love. That apparently, well, they deserve that. Thinking to myself, what they deserve is to be able to go out and earn a living so that they can survive and, well, my gosh, how about this for a concept, prosper in the mess of an economy that we have. I guarantee if somebody goes out and gets an English literature degree at this stage in the game, that by the time they get out of college, they have college debt that they will be paying off, well, forever. And they will also have a degree that is nearly worthless in the economy that exists. Because, quite honestly, people will probably not be paying for that kind of a degree. And if you throw on top of it somebody who's not, like, doesn't have a talent at it, and it's not playing to the person's strength, well, there's a double whammy. And next thing you know, they're your waiter or waitress, or they're greeting you at McDonald's, or you meet them while they're stocking shelves. Not a very high-paying job when you're trying to, well, both survive, prosper, oh, and pay off debt. Not a good thing, no matter which way you look at it. So that's the part, I guess, that is most frustrating, is that not only have we told kids that they need to go to college to get a good job, which is, well, just baloney. And quite honestly, if you're a good mechanic, a good welder, a good electrician, a good plumber, you can make six-figure salaries pretty quickly. It's not unheard of for a plumber or an electrician or a good mechanic to actually turn away business because they have more than they can handle. Interesting position to be in, especially when you think about the fact that all of that is getting worse and worse because more and more people are getting out of the business as they retire. So it was an interesting conversation. It was a frustrating conversation. And I tried to lay out kind of a game plan for the young woman to at least take stock in what her strengths were and try to determine that, taking an inventory of her own likes, dislikes, and strengths. Like I've always said, and like I told her, an employer does not pay you for anything other than your ability to do a job. If you are able to do a job, if you have competence and you have a skill or a knack or a capability, they will pay for that. But if, on the other hand, well, you don't, I mean, it would be very difficult, for example, to have something like a psychologist that, well, doesn't like to talk to people. That gets a little tricky, doesn't it? But the thing is that you have to start somewhere. And the sooner you start, the better off you'll be. So if you happen to have young children around, nieces, nephews, sons, daughters, friends, whatever, if you have an opportunity to ask them what they would like to be when they grow up, follow it up with this question. Why do you want to do that? And does that play to your strengths? And hopefully, that will be the spark of a very, very valuable conversation in that young person's life. All right, so it's a beautiful spring slash almost summer morning, and things are out, and it's supposed to be sunshiny, and life is good. Hopefully today will not be a train wreck, sort of kind of like yesterday, which even included, well, a car wreck. Gee whiz. Luckily, after reflection and checking out the car or checking out the mobile studio here and everything, no serious damage, no significant damage, although the plastic on the bottom of the bumper is, a little, I don't know, loose. I don't know if there's a crush zone in there that got crushed back or whatever. It doesn't matter. You can't tell the look at it, so in the greater scheme of things, I'm still, well, all good. And there you go. So today was another glorious day. And, it is a glorious day. Not was a glorious day. Another glorious day. Lovely day. It's Friday. I love Fridays. Fridays are absolutely fantastic. So now let's talk about the shave of the day. Now the shave of the day today, I've gone back to, single-edged razors. Well, just because, The one that I picked up was the, I think it's a gem. You know, the amazing thing is that I've got so many razors that when I grab one, I can't, you know, typically I know what it is. You know, it's, some of the Gillettes are very well known, and I'll grab them. But quite honestly, when you look at the gems and the stars and the Everettis, well, they, you know, except for the very beginning, they were all the same company. And a lot of the designs are, while maybe not exactly the same, very, very similar. So if I screw one up I can tell a couple of them. I can definitely tell my 1912, and I can definitely tell my Damascene. But after that, it gets kind of a... It's kind of a hodgepodge, quite honestly. It's kind of all over the place. So I'll go back and I'll figure that out, and we'll get that part straightened out, and I'll be able to tell you exactly which one it was. But anyhow, single edge gem razor and carbon steel PAL blade, and life is good. Lathered up the Figaro with my Nathan Clark Badger brush, and did an excellent job. The brush is It's very soft. It really is. Not quite as soft as a plisson. Softer than a bore, softer than my Samog, but it's kind of holds the middle ground, as it were. You know, it's interesting. But anyhow, a nice brush, and I like rotating between my Samogs and my plisson and my Nathan Clark Badger brush. Just because it gives me a good variety and, well, keeps me on my toes. So, all good stuff there. Now, the shave is a three-pass shave, I did do a little bit of touch-up around the chin. But it's so easy, you know, comparatively with a safety razor as compared to a straight razor. It's almost like, after I've been doing it for as long as I have, there is no need for conscious thought or control. It's like I can just turn my brain off and shave. And it's curiosity, and I can definitely see why, you know, in the greater scheme of things, from a marketing standpoint and from a selling standpoint and even from a customer standpoint, how the single-edged razors and, you know, later the double-edged razors came into vogue compared to the straight razors. Now, don't get me wrong, the straight razors are nice. Give a fabulous shave. They really do. But the single-edged and double-edged, and we'll talk specifically about the single-edged with a carbon steel blade in it, give a very, very nice shave. You know, if you did just a little bit extra work and a little bit extra touch-up, maybe a fourth pass in certain areas, you know, you could get a BBS shave very similar to what you were able to achieve with a straight razor. And the likelihood of cutting yourself because you slid or you weren't holding your hand right or whatever is, well, less. So, you know, in the greater scheme of things, there are some people who are, you know, exceedingly talented with a straight razor, and then there's probably the rest of us. So, you know, having the ability to have a shave that, well, looks straight razor close without the anxiety of cutting yourself before a meeting or a date or something like that. Yeah, I can see the sale, you know, the selling point there. It's, yeah. So anyhow, the shave was very nice. Finished it off with some Brute, just because, I enjoy the Fougere smell, and it's kind of nice. So we're running down the road, and hopefully we won't have anybody run into the back end of us. But there you go. And I got a better coffee cup this morning, too, so won't be spilling coffee all over the place like I did yesterday. Yesterday, the ride in, yesterday in the mobile studio was an absolute train wreck. We had the wreck. All we were missing was the train. In fact, I ought to get one, a little itty-bitty toy train or something, just to put on the dash, just to remind me from time to time that, yes, in fact, even in the greatest sense of things, life can be a, well, train wreck. But it happens. And it's how we deal with those episodes and how we comport ourselves during the events that is telling, as you know, if you will, of how we view life. It's sometimes things will be a train wreck, but that's okay. You know, quite honestly, like someone once said, if it wasn't for dark, you wouldn't appreciate the light. You know, and there's something to be said for that. It's interesting and kind of nice, really, that, you know, you step out of the house and you've had a moment, if you will, to compose yourself, to get your thoughts together, to reflect on, you know, how you want to deal with life today. And how you want to deal with other people, how you want to treat other people. Again, as long as the situation is not a dangerous situation, you know, you can afford to treat other people kindly and courteously and look out for their best interests first in a friendly manner. It's something that sometimes we've, in some places and at some times, we have completely lost that as a society. You know, the idea that we should look out for others' well-being before we look out for ours. You know, back in the day, that was known as being a good host. Well, you know, you're a host not just when people come to your home, but also to a certain extent when you interact with people. Now, granted, you know, you have duties and things, like if you're a salesman or something like that, you're not going to see to the other's best interests in that regard by, undercutting your own company or things like that. No, that's not what I'm talking about. But, you know, you can make sure that they are at ease, taken care of to a certain extent, comfortable with the situation. You know, those are the kinds of things. And sometimes we lose sight of that in our personal interactions. You know, there are certain places that the personal interaction is almost a dying art, if you will, and the interactions that occur are very brusque and, well, a tad brutal, and you know, you walk away from them feeling like you've just been abused. I'm sorry, that's not me. And that's one of the reasons that I enjoy living where I live, because I'm surrounded at this point in time by the majority, anyhow, of like-minded people when it comes to, well, dealing with others and making sure that everyone is comfortable as can be. You know, some people call it Southern hospitality. I just call it being a kind human being. You know, you don't have to be from the South to be friendly and nice and concerned with another individual. And to a certain extent, that's why we share. That's why we evangelize wet shaving, because we know that, you know, it will be better for the individual. And I'm convinced that that's one of the reasons that we share it, is because, you know, when you have a good thing, you want to say, hey, look what look at this. This is good. You'd like it too. So we do it to a certain extent. So think about that as you go about your day, and see if you can't extend that into your relations with others. Well, all across the board. And what you'll find, or at least what I find, is makes me a generally happier person. It makes me a happier person. Regardless of what it does for other people, it makes me a happier person. It's like it lifts a bit of weight off my shoulders, you know, as I wander through this journey we call life. So anyhow, that's kind of the thought for this morning, and hopefully everything's good with you, and I would hope that you too have a beautiful sunshiny day. Got a party to go to this afternoon, so don't know. I may have to do an afternoon shave. Well, just because, and we'll see. But right now, it's off at the Donut Factory for well, a little bit more fun, and you know, playing around, and it's, you know, kind of like playing in a sandbox. It's you know, you run outside, you play, and it's all good, and you don't want to come home until mom yells for you. Yeah, it's sometimes it's kind of like that, and hopefully you've got a job like that too. But anyhow, right now I do, so it's all good stuff, and I'm rather reveling in it because it's been a while since I've had anything that that I enjoyed quite to that level. So anyhow, we'll talk to you the next time. All right, so the shave of the day today. Shave of the day today was pretty quick. 1305 Samog brush, an old Ever-Ready hammerhead. I guess it's an Ever-Ready, not a gem. Shows you what I know. One thing that I noticed about it, though, is that it's brass. And brass, as they sit around and, you know, not under a polish, if you will, they get, well, a patina. And honestly, that patina drags just a little bit. It's almost like there's a little bit of an oxide layer there, and that's what causes that patina. But as you use it, it has a tendency to polish up just in a very small area, and it's that polish that that provides a really nice feel and good slickness of the razor on your face. So if you have an old razor, an old brass razor that is that feels like it's dragging a little bit, even though you are using a soap that is supposed to have really good glide properties, check the patina. Check to see if it's not polished up. Check to see if it's got that old brass look instead of a shiny brass look, because it may need to be shined up, and then once it is, it'll probably function, well, a whole lot better. So, using the Ever-Ready single-edged razor that does, in fact, have a little bit of a patina on the majority of the head with then a small area that is nice and kind of polished, if you will, it does have very nice glide and face feel and everything. Whipped up some gondolier, some Phoenix gondolier, and threw it on and proceeded to shave with it. Now, I only did a two-pass shave, and it was just a two-pass shave. And I had experimented just a little bit. I had surmised that you know, a two-pass shave would do a good job, as it has in the past. What I'll do is one pass going down, and then the second pass will be an against the grain pass. And depending on which side I am, the grain is slightly different, so it's a little bit different pattern. You know, went ahead and did that this morning, and well, turned out good. Was in a bit of a hurry, didn't grab an aftershave, and that's okay. You know, every now and then you just kind of take it on well, without any extra. And so that was the shave of the day today. Again, if you've got an old brass razor and if you're slightly disappointed with it, and in fact, for that matter, a chrome razor or an aluminum razor, if it's got an oxide layer on it too, it might be inducing some drag on you and not be quite the razor that you think it should be. And so polish the razor up and see if it doesn't do a little bit better for you. All right, here we go. A rant about rants. Now, last week I did a segment on compliance and the fact that we have basically been beaten down in this society to all be compliant. And on many different fronts and in many different avenues, people go out of their way to make sure we don't talk about anything that is in any way construed as not correct, not polite, not PC, not, well, whatever. And the problem that I always have with that is, well, who the hell gets to decide? Anyhow, so let's talk about rants. This was an interesting thing that just kind of jumped out at me. Went to church Sunday. And the pastor's up there, and he is going off on an absolute tear. He is he's finally speaking his mind and saying the things that I think he has wanted to say for, well, a long time. And my wife looks over at me, and she said at one point, "Wow, he's really angry." And that's when it dawned on me. And that's what kind of was the impetus for this, well, discussion about rants. Okay, we call them rants. We call them rants, and to a certain extent, we look down on them. The problem is that in most cases, the reason that a person is ranting is because, or supposedly ranting, is because they are passionate about something. And what I have surmised is, again, within society as a large, we have gone out of our way and done our darndest, well, to make sure that people are not passionate about anything, or if they are, well, to sit down, shut the hell up, and just, you know, leave everybody else alone. Because if you notice, if anybody gets passionate, if anybody gets loud, if anybody gets, well, just a little bit, you know, excited, animated, all of a sudden, they're not labeled as passionate. They're labeled as mad. They're labeled as confrontational. And it automatically puts a stigma on whatever it is they're saying to the point that it can be dismissed. So at that point, it doesn't matter what they've said because, well, they were mad. They were, you know, upset. No, they were passionate. And you'd pissed them off because, more than likely, you were being an idiot. But the thing is that rants have a place. They really, really do. And people rant and people carry on because they are passionate about things. And we've gotten to a point where people don't want to hear other people's rants in general. Whereas on an individual basis, if you happen to agree with the person, you're sitting there going, "Yeah, yeah, give it to them, give them more." But at the same time, you're probably thinking to yourself, "Oh, hell, I'll never do that. No way." You know, you think about some of the YouTubers that are, well, infamous for, you know, putting it on the line and saying it like it is. And we give a lot of crap to those people, but at the same time, they're admired. Now, how can you have both? How can they be admired and receive a lot of crap all at the same time? I just don't get that. But the thing is that, okay, so we have gotten to a point where if somebody goes off on a tear, they're to be dismissed. They're to be looked at as, well, they can't control themselves. You know, they're mad at things. It's like, really? How about paying attention to what it is they're actually saying? How about being a part of the conversation and instead of having the thoughts and ideas handed to you on a gilded platter, how about listening to the conversation, listening to what the person is saying, and choosing and picking the pieces of the conversation that you would like to digest and listen to out of the conversation on your own? And it really makes me wonder if this hand-it-to-me for free society that we have nowadays has once again gone a little bit further off the deep end. Maybe that's what it is. I don't know. It's one of those things, and it's, am I upset about it? No, I'm disappointed. I am terribly disappointed because we've gotten to a situation where if you say something that I disagree with, and if you say it with any passion at all, you are mad and you are ranting, and therefore I can dismiss and discount everything that you say. On the other hand, if I happen to agree with you, well then, all of a sudden, this is good stuff, and you're the man, and, go get them, okay? The problem with that whole premise is what it completely avoids, what it completely negates, is considering another's point of view, which means we don't learn, which means we stagnate, which means somebody somewhere has set the rules and it's up to us to just abide by them in a compliant fashion and never rock the boat and change our minds. Now, the question then is, who wins? the people who win are the ones that are setting those standards and the ones that saying that are saying that this side is good and that side is bad and we should all be against that side. And meanwhile, while we're fighting amongst ourselves about who's right and who's wrong and who's good or bad, these other clowns are doing something completely different that all of us would disagree with, and they're doing it and nobody's watching them. They're laughing their way all the way to the bank. And that happens way more than people know. So I ask you, do you appreciate rants, especially the ones that you don't agree with? Do you listen to them? Or do you just turn them off and go, man, that guy's just pissed? Do you try to take the nuggets out of them and think for yourself and decide, huh, yeah, that may be a good point. Ah, never thought of it that way. You know, for the hardcore Republicans, do they, conservatives, the one that, are thinking that all Democrats are absolutely evil. Do you listen to Bill Maher every now and then, listen to his comedy show and you know, see if he makes some good points? You know, for the hardcore, Democrats, do you listen to Rush Limbaugh every now and then when he goes on a tear and see if he's making some good points? Hey, you got to ask yourself, why not? You know, sometimes there's more than one way to skin a cat. Somewhere in the middle is the truth. And if anybody was to tell me that either the Republicans are right or the Democrats are right, I would tell you that they're both wrong in a lot of things. And they're also both right in some things. The thing is that somebody, somewhere, within this society has gone to a lot of trouble, to make sure that we fight amongst ourselves about everything, rich, poor, city, rural, Democrat, liberal, Democrat, Republican, liberal, conservative, rich, poor. It's everywhere. Black, white, Hispanic, everybody else. It's everywhere. And if you listen to what they say, they have a tendency to try to make it sound like, our side is good and the other side is bad and evil. This even goes to international realms, okay? And you have to wonder, why? Who's benefiting from this? Is it just to make news? Is it just to make headlines? Or is it to control people and to make sure that, once again, we're a compliant bunch of fools out here just sitting around drinking a beer and watching our programs? Have you ever wondered why it's called programs? Yeah. Absorb that programming and function the way you're supposed to, you mindless robot. I wonder if it's a situation where when people rant, it's when they finally said, enough of the programming. There's something here that I care deeply about, and the programming cannot overcome. And I am going to, loosen the reins of the normal, everyday, individual programming that I've been assailed with. I'm going to slip those reins, and I'm going to let fly on this subject. And wouldn't it be nice if that happened and people actually paid attention and listened, instead of just sitting there and saying, wow, he's awful mad today.
Well, that concludes this episode of the Brush and Soap and Blade Podcast. I hope you enjoyed listening to it as much as I enjoyed making it. If you have some suggestions or would like a topic covered, drop me an email at brushandsoapandblade@gmail.com or give me a call at 864-372-6234 or contact us on Twitter at Brush and Blade. You can also visit us at our blog, brushandsoapandblade.wordpress.com. As always, we're available on iTunes and Stitcher.